Beyond Good and Evil is a 2003 action-adventure game developed by Ubisoft. Much like most games covered on this channel, Beyond Good and Evil was a bit of an anomaly. The game's development was led by Michel Ancel, the creator of the Rayman series. The funny thing is that the Beyond Good and Evil that we got is very different from the original concept. See, one of the main goals of the game was to create a meaningful, engaging story with all the bells and whistles of a big-budget Hollywood movie, while at the same time offering players a high degree of gameplay freedom. According to Ancel himself, the idea was to make the player feel like an explorer with a sense of absolute freedom, and pack a whole universe onto a single CD, mountains, planets, and towns. If that sounds incredibly ambitious for 2003, that's because it was. Beyond Good and Evil was first shown at E3 2002, where it was received, let's say, not very enthusiastically. In a 2011 interview for Game Informer, Ancel recalls that there was no applause and nobody to talk to after the presentation. That's kind of sad. It's hard to imagine that there was a time when Ubisoft, the corporate behemoth of today, got snubbed at conferences like a movie that is not pastel-colored and set in a historical period at Cannes. But hey, at least Peter Jackson thought it was neat. That has to count for something. Well, actually, it kinda did. Ancel went on to collaborate with Jackson himself on King Kong, which is one of the best video game adaptations of a movie ever made. So, because the game was received so poorly at E3, the game went through substantial changes in order to make it more commercially appealing. This involved removing long segments of exploration, which shortened the campaign significantly, and redesigning Jade, the protagonist, who was originally a teenage girl. Anyway, I think their decision to downsize worked out quite well in the end. The game was universally praised for its story, characters, and world design, and got several Game of the Year awards. But, and I think you knew this was coming, the game sold like shit. And that's putting it politely, it fucking bombed. I'm not an expert or anything, but I do like analyzing this stuff, at least on a hobbyist level. So why did Beyond Good and Evil sell so poorly? According to basically the entire internet, it was a combination of poor timing and little to no marketing. The 2003 holiday season was packed with high profile games. We're talking Star Wars KOTOR, Call of Duty, Need for Speed Underground, Deus Ex Invisible War, and Ubisoft's own Prince of Persia The Sands of Time, in which Ubisoft poured most of their marketing efforts in. Oh, and let's not forget about big rigs over the road racing. You can't possibly expect to compete with that. But here's the thing. Even if Beyond Good and Evil did everything right, got a standing ovation at E3 2002, didn't drop in one of the busiest holiday seasons in gaming history, and got promoted by the brightest marketing minds in the world, I still think it would've bombed. The truth is, Beyond Good and Evil was too weird, too avant-garde for 2003. I mean, come on, it's a puzzle-centric action-adventure exploration game with anthropomorphic animals, an investigative journalist as its protagonist, and a political plot that was inspired by the September 11 attacks. It was a bit too much for 2003. But hey, 2003 was 18 years ago. The game has gained a cult following over the years, and sales have slowly picked up since its release. A sequel is in the works, which has totally not been in development hell for the last, let's see, 13 years? So things are looking up for the franchise. The joke is that the opposite of what I've just said has happened. Being an old game, Beyond Good and Evil requires some workarounds to make it presentable on modern systems. The first thing you'll want is enable widescreen support. The good news is that doing so is beyond simple. Simply get Idarian's widescreen fix, copy-paste it in the game's installation folder, and edit the file. To remove the pillar box, just do what I did here and you should be fine. Now, for some reason, the second time I applied this fix, I started getting this weird graphical glitch in menu and cutscene transitions. I don't know what caused it. I'll do my best to edit around it though. One more thing, for some inexplicable reason, this game would not allow me to alt-tab. To enable alt-tabbing, you have to, get this, rename the fucking executable. And that's it, you're good to go. Beyond Good and Evil is surprisingly stable for an 18-year-old game.
No, it's just, okay, we'll go together. But I'm sticking to you like bees on honey, whether you like it or not. Segundo, check over this computer and download a complete version of your OS. You'll be able to take a look at it, Jade. As for me, I'll try to get that stupid hovercraft up and running. Jesus. Why is this whole place falling apart?
Beyond Good and Evil takes place in 2445, on the mining planet of Hillis. At the beginning of the story, the planet is in the midst of a political and social crisis of sorts. Hillis is under siege by aliens called Dom-Z, who kidnap the planet's inhabitants to drain their life force or implant them with spores to turn them into slaves. Meanwhile, a military dictatorship called the Alpha Sections has come to power on Hillis, promising to protect its citizens from the growing threat of the aliens. As these things usually go, the Alpha Sections seem to be suspiciously incapable of taking care of their alien problem, which leads the majority of the populace to believe that they're in cahoots with the aliens. And that's exactly what the Resistance is trying to prove. This is where you come in. You play as Jade, a photojournalist and a new member of the Resistance. I mentioned earlier that the setting was too out there for the AAA gaming landscape of 2003. Back then, the gaming industry was trying to shift towards a more mature direction. The industry as a whole was going through a bit of an identity crisis. You had games like Max Payne 2, Manhunt, True Crime Streets of LA, GTA Vice City, the first Call of Duty, 13, all titles with gritty settings and elements of prestige media trying to compensate for a collective, let's call it inferiority complex, caused by the fact that games were still considered toys for children, basically. Whether they achieved the same level of quality as their Hollywood counterparts is up for debate, but that's beside the point. But Beyond Good and Evil does approach mature themes and subject matters. Jade and her uncle Paige run a shelter for children who are orphaned by the war with the aliens. The Alpha Sections run an incompetent dictatorial government that's hell-bent on squashing civil liberties and freedom of speech. Hell, the game even comments on how the media spins events to fit the government agenda. That's literally in the first 10 minutes. Hell, you even discover the true extent of the heinous actions the aliens perform on the planet's citizens. But, you know, it had talking pigs and humanoid rhinos with questionable Jamaican accents.
Jade, take a load off your feet, man. You're gonna kill yourself running around like that.
They just don't teach you how to promote such anomalies in marketing school. Bear in mind that this is just my interpretation of events. It's literally just me pouring my thoughts onto digital paper while listening to Vijay Iyer's excellent 2021 jazz album Uneasy. That has to be the most pretentious thing I've ever said. Anyway, you get the idea. As for how I felt about the setting and the story, I found them quite charming. I like the contrast between its cartoony, slightly family-friendly but not really world design, and its mature themes and biting social commentary, even though this same contrast did cause quite a tonal disconnect at times. One moment you're marveling at the planet's beautiful landscapes and diverse ecosystem, bonding and bantering with your pig uncle and feel like you're in a PG-13 adventure movie, and in the next you're snapping photos of slave transports and torture devices for your Resistance buddies. Thing is, if you really start digging into the game's deeper meanings, you realize that it's quite fucked up. There was one moment where I was strolling through the in-game city, and for some reason the propaganda blaring through the megaphones and broadcasted on the public screens reminded me of the stories my grandfather used to tell me about Soviet oppression as a kid. I don't know, maybe these things hit differently for me since I grew up in Eastern Europe. So that's my ranty take on the setting. I know I didn't go as in-depth as in other videos, but I felt that a deep dive into why it failed to capture audiences back when the game dropped made for a more interesting discussion than the setting itself. Again, this is just my interpretation, please don't destroy me in the comments, I'm experimenting with a new freaking format so the algorithm will notice me, please subscribe, like, comment. From a presentation standpoint, Beyond Good and Evil doesn't feel like an 18-year-old game. It's a quite a looker, and a sounder. The first thing that becomes apparent as soon as the first cutscene plays is the high production values. You got your shot reverse shots, artsy slow-mo transitions, your camera panning, and other filmmaking techniques that I'm in no way qualified to talk about. But all that nerd film stuff, it's here. With the risk of sounding all buzzwordy, the game certainly feels cinematic, which was actually the intent of the developers. The game looks and feels just as good outside cutscenes. The animations are stunning for their time. My jaw dropped the first time I saw Jade chimneying herself up between two walls. By the way, I'm sorry, I don't know the official parkour term for this. Trust me, I looked it up. Or how Jade staggers slightly when falling on her feet. Or how about this creature's antennas wiggling timidly as it creeps out of its hiding hole. While some aspects like the facial animations and some ugly textures don't hold up, it's these little touches that help Beyond Good and Evil stand the test of time. I also have to mention the music. The soundtrack includes a wide variety of languages, instruments, and genres, such as Arabic string instruments, Indian percussion, tribal vocal chants, and even a bit of early 2000s electronica and hip-hop. Let's have a listen. One track in particular caught my attention. Those of you who have played Beyond Good and Evil probably know what I'm talking about. It's the one playing in the Resistance bar. I had this whole bit planned out where I said that this is how aliens trying to reverse engineer 2003 hip-hop would sound like, that I could see Space Usher and Space Lil Jon fucking with this beat and yelling this gibberish. Thankfully, I did some digging and discovered that the gibberish is Bulgarian and the song samples a telephone conversation the composer had with his Bulgarian friend. Also, the name of the song apparently alludes to the Soviet propaganda of the Cold War. And yeah, this track is absolutely intoxicating. Good stuff, man, not gonna lie. And to think I was so close to making a fool of myself. But even with this newfound information, I can still see Space Usher and Space Lil Jon fucking with this beat. I'm sorry. There are some aspects of the presentation that haven't aged that well, though. For one, the camera is... how do I put this? It oscillates between serviceable and infuriatingly atrocious. I think the issue lies in the fact that the game changes between perspectives often, sometimes from one room to another to make stealth sections more approachable. Like one room is in third person and in the next it switches to this weird angle that I don't have the spatial knowledge, let's call it, to describe. And the camera can't make up its mind, so it defaults to a kind of middle ground that makes the environment difficult to interact with. You have to experience it firsthand to get what I'm talking about. I've also noticed some audio syncing issues during cutscenes, but I'm sure it's a compatibility issue. There are fan-made patches out there for this. It didn't bother me too much, so I didn't bother fixing it. I was grateful I managed to make this thing run and recordable. These old games are finicky anyway. You apply one tiny fix on top of others and the whole thing comes crashing down like a house of cards. And that's it as far as the presentation is concerned. So let's move on to the gameplay. Beyond Good and Evil is a bit of an odd one. The gameplay has two layers, exploration, which branches out into multiple, let's call them mini mechanics, and combat. Let's start with the former. So I mentioned earlier that the devs had to make several compromises to make Beyond Good and Evil more commercially appealing. One of them was significantly reducing the scale of the world. The game was originally conceptualized as an open-world adventure game. The idea was to make the player feel less like a photojournalist that provides the resistance with content for their hipster samizdat and more like a space explorer, which is in line with what the much-delayed sequel is going for. What we got instead was a much smaller world world that the players can explore in between missions, as well as a small hub area where players can stock up with supplies and pick up this game's version of side quests. I call them side quests, but they don't really fit the traditional definition of side quests. They're more in the lines of, hey, there's some sweet loot in X cave, maybe you should go check it out. Instead of,
bring me 20 fucking shark skins, you piece of shit, or you're not getting the XP, I swear to fucking god.
It's nice to feel like a game is actually treating me like a human being with agency and letting me decide whether I want to pursue these side missions for a change. Of course, I chose not to. Anyway, so the game world itself is neither small nor necessarily dense with activities, but it makes effective use of its space. If you just want to focus on the story missions and skip the open exploration segments, I have some bad news for you. You can't. To advance the story, you need to buy upgrades for your hovercraft. These upgrades can only be purchased with pearls, which is one of the game's currencies, and the only way to acquire enough pearls to afford these extensions is by exploring and engaging in side activities. Some people might be down with this method of gating progress, but personally, I don't know how to feel about it. I like to blaze through games on subsequent playthroughs, and having to do all this busy work kinda ruins Beyond's replay value, at least for me. To the game's credit, the side activities are pretty fun. Two of them are effectively the same. One has you recover your money stolen by a looter through a labyrinth of obstacles, and the other is, well, hovercraft races. Win them and you get X number of pearls. They're fun, but there's nothing more to them. One of the most interesting gameplay mechanics involves Jade's photography job. I really love how it got introduced in the game. The shield protecting Jade's and Paige's orphan shelter from outside threats got deactivated due to a lack of funds. So Secundo, their AI who can't make its mind up between a Spanish and an Italian accent, finds Jade a job. This job involves cataloging all the species on Hillis for a science museum. Jade takes some pictures, sends them to the museum, pays the bill, and this mechanic gets carried over to the rest of the game. As novel as this mechanic might be, the game doesn't do much with it. You snap a few photos of species, and once you fill up a roll of film, a pearl presumably shipped by the science museum magically materializes in your pocket. The player's involvement is limited to having to frame the picture correctly, which would have been fine if the game offered me at least a couple of lines of flavor text about these animals. All you get is this lady going, "Ooh, such a pretty picture, Jade. Ooh, look at the cute animal. Thank you for doing our legwork." Okay, I'm being a little facetious. To the game's credit, the devs did try to put as many spins on this mechanic as it's humanly possible by making some more solitary animals harder to photograph and even building a whole puzzle around it. But, and you know I can't spend 20 seconds without bitching, it all falls apart when photographing hostile animals. I spent a full 10 minutes trying to capture these jumpy fucking worms on camera. Most of the game's content is reserved to the self-contained mission areas. Beyond has only 5 story missions, but each of them can take up to an hour and a half to complete. All missions offer an equal mix of platforming, stealth, combat, and puzzle solving. I'm not gonna waste your time by breaking down each of them exhaustively, so I'm just gonna cover the highlights in a stream of consciousness style. Let's talk about the puzzles. If you've been following my channel for long enough, you probably already know that I dislike puzzles in general and puzzle platformers in particular. But in the case of Beyond Good and Evil, I actually enjoy them. The designers managed to hit that sweet spot between telegraphing the solutions without outright revealing them. In most cases, there will be an environmental hint subtly pushing you in the right direction. Early game puzzles are designed mostly around performing certain actions in tandem with your companion via contextual commands. For example, this puzzle has the player order their companion to perform a special action, in this case stomping the ground to raise this cave balloon, so that Jade can launch it in a pile of explosives, clearing the path in the process. This type of puzzle is repeated throughout the game in various forms, but at no point did it feel like lazy copy-pasting. Later, the game introduces a neat little gadget called the Gyro Disc Launcher. This is when the game's puzzle design takes an interesting turn, both for the better and the worse, but mostly the former. Now, the good thing about this gadget is that the puzzles designed around it require a higher degree of out-of-the-box thinking. There were two gyro disc-centric puzzles that stood out to me. The first example involves a locked gate. I spent half an hour trying to find the solution, searching every nook and cranny, even backtracking, but to no avail. I then noticed an opening in the gate. I pushed a crate, hopped on it, peeked through the hole, saw the button, shot a disc with my launcher, and opened the gate. The second example is slightly more complicated to explain, so bear with me. The main objective of this puzzle is getting your companion above the docking area. He's too large to fit through the only accessible route, and the other is locked behind the gate. The problem is that the gate is on a timer, so physically pushing the button is not an option, because by the time you dodged all the traps, jumped down on the docks and entered the hovercraft, the gate will have already been closed. So what you should do instead is get as close as possible to the hovercraft and activate the button from a distance with your gyrodisc launcher. This will give you enough time to enter the hovercraft and reach the other side before the gate shuts down. And now your companion can reach the area above the docks, help you push a crate and access the vent connecting directly to a main story area. The fact that I had as much fun writing about this puzzle as I had solving it is a testament to this game's high quality puzzle design. The strange thing is that they didn't even feel like puzzles, if that makes any sense. They're so well integrated into the level design that they didn't even register as puzzles at the moment. The same thing goes for the platforming puzzles. These types of puzzles have a nasty reputation of breaking the flow of the game when implemented badly. That's totally not the case here. I enjoyed every second of them, and the developer's decision to experiment with camera angles was very inspired. It confers them with a bit more visual flair as well as a sense of urgency. Not all puzzles are perfect though. One time I effectively softlocked myself by pushing two crates into each other, and I had to reload the previous save. Then there's that infuriating stealth puzzle where you have to sneak between two crates as an elevator is ascending to avoid being detected by enemies. The problem with it is that it's entirely trial and error based, and detection leads to instant death. I don't understand how the designers expected the players to magically know where the guards would pop up from ahead of time. On top of that, the window to sneak between crates is quite short, so you have to position yourself exactly at the edge of enemy visibility to reach the other crate in time. And then, as soon as you learn the patterns, the game throws a wrench into your plans by having an enemy enter the platform. This comes out of nowhere, so you'll probably panic, get detected, killed, and respawned at the beginning. I could spend another 10 minutes complaining about this puzzle, but I don't think it would benefit the video. Still, I want to tell you from the bottom of my heart that I hate this puzzle and everything it represents. Now, mind you, the game thankfully doesn't over-rely on mandatory insta-death stealth sections. Jade is weaker than the Alpha section troops and not much of a fighter. Outsmarting troopers by exploiting their weak spots is more recommended than confronting them directly. Why risk your life when you can just shoot their gas canisters and kick them in the ether? The problem is that apart from a few, let's call them environmental enemy disposal methods, this is the only way to confront them indirectly. Which is a shame because the hand-to-hand combat is definitely the weakest part of Beyond Good and Evil. There are no weapon upgrades or power-ups or interesting abilities to play around with. All you get is this shitty space staff, a couple of combos, and that's about it. I'm fully aware of the fact that this is thematically appropriate. After all, Jade is an investigative reporter, not a fighter, but I don't think that's enough to justify the lack of options. Still, even with all of these quirks, Beyond Good and Evil is an enjoyable experience. The strength of Beyond's gameplay lies not in its individual mechanics necessarily, but in how they are paced and mixed and meshed. Nothing overstays its welcome. If you find yourself disliking a particular section, there's always something interesting around the corner, be it a hovercraft puzzle or a secret stash of sweet loot. And that'll be it for this video. Overall, I've enjoyed my time with Beyond Good and Evil, and I definitely recommend you pick it up. There are many things I haven't covered, like the incredible story, Jade's bond with her companions, and the writing, but I'll let you discover those things on your own. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.